Hi, greetings to all. In today's video on homeopathic posology, I'm going to discuss in general the indications and the contraindications of high, medium and low potency. I hope you enjoy this video.
Hello everybody. Today we'll be discussing the indications and contraindications for the use of high, medium and low potencies. So let us see what are the indications for use of high potency. Naturally, the most important one will be higher the similarity the drug bears to the disease. So more the similarity, higher is the potency, or greater the correspondence of the remedy to the totality presented by the patient. So whatever totality is there, and if that correspondence is around 90%, 95% or even 100%, or between 90 to 100%, then we can say it has a greater correspondence of the remedy to the totality. Therefore, we can give a high potency. And even remedies that are well proved. So basically, all our constitutional remedies, which are well proved, they can also be given, or they can be also be used rather in the high potency. Even in a case, if you have got predominant mental symptoms in a case, so if you've got mental symptoms in a case pertaining to the will, emotion, intellect, or the subconscious, or even abrasions of perceptions like illusions, delusions, and hallucinations, you can definitely opt for the higher potency. Or even well-qualified mental symptoms. Meaning well-qualified mental symptoms, meaning what? Those mental symptoms which have an accompanying modality. For example, weeps easily and is better by consolation. So this is a qualified mental. Or obstinate, aggravated by the least contradiction. Again, this becomes a well-qualified mental symptom. So if a well-qualified mental symptom is there, or more PQRS or more character symptoms are there on the mental level, then we can definitely go for the high potency. Or as Dr. Hahnemann has correctly said, the peculiar, rare, strange, uncommon symptoms also are there. That can also be an indication for high potency or even characteristic symptoms in a given case. Remedies that are inert in the crude state, the higher potency gives good result. So the remedies like salt, that is natrum mur, or sand, that is silica, in their crude state, they are totally inert. But when potentized, they give miraculous symptomatology or extremely good symptoms. So therefore, in such remedies which were inert in their crude state and on potentization, they are bought into activity, generally speaking, higher potencies can yield good result. Poisonous drugs are generally administered in high potency. So poisonous drugs, for example, laxatives, you can give it in the high potency. In all acute illnesses, generally high potency is of use. And even when the susceptibility is high, because it will throw out characteristic symptoms, therefore, more the characteristic symptoms, higher is the potency. Also, allergy to chemicals or drugs respond well if the same chemical or drug is potentized and given in high potency. So if you can use the totopathic method, that whatever chemical or drug you are allergic to, or it has been caused after taking this medicine, you can potentize that medicine and give it to the patient, and generally it is given in the high potency. Also, cases that no longer respond to the lower or the medium potencies, indication remaining the same. That means in a case, if you are given the 30th potency, the 200 potency, and the case comes to a standstill, yet some symptoms are there which have to be ameliorated. And in spite of repeating adequately in the 30th or 200 potency, not much difference is there. So in such instances, we have to go to the higher potency, that is the 1M potency. So whenever the potency has exhausted its action, then the next higher potency can be given. So in this case, we have tried the lower potency, we have tried the medium potency, that is the 30th potency on the centesimal scale, 200 potency also on the centesimal scale, and now we go to the 1M. And as you all know, nozals are generally employed in high potency. In my last video on dosage also, I have told you that nozodes are given generally in 1M and above, Dr. Kent was of the opinion to give 10 mm and above. So nozodes are generally employed in high potencies. Maybe a few authors also say that it can be given also in the 200 potency. Now let us see what are the contraindications for the high potency. Naturally, in any advanced pathological state, where the pathology is advanced, it is irreversible. End organ damage is there. So in such instances, the potency cannot be given high. So it is contraindicated. Secondly, idiosyncratic or hypersensitive patients. Here also, in idiosyncratic or hypersensitive patients, the high potency cannot be given. Otherwise, a tremendous aggravation will be caused. So in such cases, as you all know, the susceptibility is extremely high. So the slightest stimulus will cause an aggravation. And naturally, cases which have a low susceptibility, the susceptibility extremely low, then you just cannot go in for a high potency. You have to see the other factors of the case before going to a high potency. In one-sided diseases with less characteristic signs and symptoms. So as you all know, one-sided diseases are those diseases which exhibit only one or two principal symptoms. And all the other symptoms are less characteristic in nature. So in such diseases, in such one-sided diseases, you cannot go in for a high potency. You have to start first with a low potency and then gradually increase it, provided the previous remedy and the potency has shown beneficial effect. Or they are predominant common symptoms in a case. So in a case, generally this will come in a case with advanced pathology, when there's a predominant common symptoms. So in advanced pathology, you will generally get the common symptoms which are much more in number as compared to the characteristic or the peculiar, rare and strange symptoms. Anyway, this will depend upon the state of susceptibility. So if the susceptibility is low, naturally you'll only get common symptoms. So in such instances, you cannot give the high potency. But however, if the susceptibility is high and in spite of being an advanced pathological case, the person is exhibiting or expressing characteristic symptoms. So in such instances, high potency has to be used with caution. In cases where susceptibility is either medium or low. So naturally, if the susceptibility is either low or medium, then you cannot go in for the high potency. Again, you have to see the different aspects of the case also. Now let us see indication for use of medium potency. So basically, it can be safely given in patients who are hypersensitive. So hypersensitive people who have allergies or who are idiosyncratic, they will respond very well to the medium potencies. Please remember that a too low potency or a too high potency given in hypersensitive or allergic or idiosyncratic patients will give an aggravation. So as I told you in my previous video also, that in such cases, you have to keep in the middle path or on the most safe path, that is the middle path. So the medium potency can be safely be used for such patients. And you can start with the low potency and then gradually step up the potency. So in such instances, in such patients who are hypersensitive, who are allergic, or those who are idiosyncratic, you can start with the low potency, see how they respond. If they respond in a favorable manner and a point in time comes where they are not responding now to the 30th potency of the same remedy, then you review the case and you find out the totality remains the same. The only problem is lies with the potency. That means what? The 30th potency has already exhausted its action. So therefore, we can then gradually step up the potency and go to the next potency. But however, this has to be done with caution. Now, contraindication is the only contraindication is there that where the susceptibility is either low or high. Now, for the low potency, indications for use of low potency. So, in cases where the susceptibility is low, naturally you will give a low potency. In advanced cases with gross pathology, wherein the susceptibility is also low, you given a low potency. Or in other words, you have tissue changes with advanced pathological changes And in these advanced pathological changes, they have an irreversible pathology. So gross tissue changes with advanced pathological state, you can definitely go for a low potency, or an pathology which is totally irreversible with end organ damage, you directly go in for a low potency. Or gross pathological changes in vital organs, which I've told you again, you go in for a low potency. Now, again, in a case where you are getting an array of common symptoms and you hardly get any PQRS or characteristic symptoms. It could be a one-sided disease, it could be a paucity of symptom, it could be a maze of symptoms, and so on. So in such instances, the common symptoms which are exhibited, then you can use a low potency. And in a case, suppose you get less number of mental symptoms and more physical general. So less number of mental symptoms and more the physical general symptoms, it goes in for an indication for the use of low potency. And more common pathological symptoms are there. So even in an advanced pathological state, you can take up these pathological symptoms which are common to the case. For example, keloids, disc formation, thysis, calculi, and so on and so forth. So in such instances also, when you're using Boger's method and giving the importance to the pathological symptoms which are common to the disease, then the use of low potency can be advocated. And in a case where you're getting only a few characteristic physical general symptoms or again common symptoms, again low potency is indicated. And organ remedies are best given in low potency. In the previous video of dosage, I've already told you that organ remedies are given in low potencies. Why? Because the symptoms are very difficult. Number one, symptoms may be difficult to elicit because the patient may be illiterate. Second, the pathology is quite advanced, as a result of which only common symptoms are there and you cannot identify the characteristic symptoms. So in such instances, whatever tissue affinity or system affinity or organ affinity that remedy has, that you can use as an organ remedy, and you can start off with a low potency. Sarcos also are given in low potency, and biochemic medicines are given on cost indications. Therefore, it is given on the low potency. For example, biochemic medicines given on cost indications. For example, Kalifos, you can give it for deficient memory or difficult concentration. Then Kalisulf for cold and cough, or nasal discharge or expectoration, recurrent expectoration, or Natrum Phos for diabetes, etc. Then remedies which are not very well proved also can be given in the low potency. Why? Because the symptomatology is not known completely of the ill-proved medicine or the ill-proved remedy. So in such instances, if a symptom similarity is there and if the remedy is indicated, then you can give the remedy which is not well proved in the low potency. Or when you take a case and you're not very sure whether to give remedy A or to give remedy B, then in such instances, according to your best judgment, you choose either A or B and give it in the low potency. Mode of action would be to give a placebo, basically. If you're not very sure what remedy to give, you can give a placebo, you can repertorize the case, you can refer Matra Medica, and then you can be sure of the remedy and give it. However, if you do not have the time or due to unavoidable circumstances, you are giving the remedy and which you're not very sure of, give it in the low potency with infrequent repetition. And even rare remedies are there which do not have any characteristic symptoms. They also have to be given in the low potency. Now let us see the contraindications for the low potency. Number one, extremely hypersensitive patients. So as I told you, in hypersensitive patients also, you have to keep in the middle path. So a too low or a too high potency will aggravate. So cases with marked mental symptomatology. So in a case, you only got majority of the mental symptoms and very little of the physical general symptoms are there. So in such instances, more the mental symptoms it will go in for a high potency. Therefore, the low potency cannot be given, or the susceptibility is high or medium. Then nosos also are not given in the low potency. They are always given in the higher potency. Even poisons are not given in the low potency. And poisonous substances like lactases, heavy metals, spider group, hydrocyanic acid, prussic acid, the scorpion group, etc., all of them are not given in the low potencies. And I repeat, idiosyncratic or hypersensitive patients, low potency is not given, as an unnecessary aggravation may be precipitating. Now, there's one important note on the ascending scale of potencies. This was discovered by Margaret Tyler, who was a student of Dr. Kent. So it may so happen that there's a failure of reaction. Even when the best indicated remedy is repeated, the indications being the same. So when you're taking the case, you have found out a correct medicine and you are giving it to the patient. But in spite of that, there is no reaction, or there's poor reaction, or there is lack of reaction. So you again retake the case and you found out that the indications are the same, the remedy is the same. In such instances, you can go in for the ascending scale of potencies. Now let us see what is this ascending scale of potencies. It means a single dose of each being repeated on a consecutive days. So for 3 consecutive days, 3 potencies are repeated in a systematic order. Either you can start with 30, 200, 1M, 200, 1N, 10M, 1N, 10M, 50M, and so on and so forth. So on the one day, for example, you're giving remedy A in the 30 potency one dose. Second day, you're giving remedy A in the 200 potency one dose. And third day, you're giving remedy A 1M in the third day, only one dose. So each day for 3 days, one dose is given with different potencies. So it is repeated till the point of reaction only. So when you do this, moment the reaction starts, you stop it. So this, as I told you, Margaret Tyler recommended in cases which are resistant and not responding to the indicated drug. And she was a fellow or student of Dr. Kent. So Margaret Tyler said in cases of high fever or in cases of mania, such a method of using the ascending scale of potencies is useful, whereby the action takes place, or the reaction which was poor, it is roused into activity and the action will take place and you'll be able to give good result. So this is about the ascending scale of potencies. Now let us see in our homeopathic literature, who were high potency prescribers? Well, they were Dr. Kent, Dr. Pulford, Dr. Gross, Dr. Rowe, Dr. Lippi, Dr. Tyler, Sir John Weir, Dr. Guernsey, Dr. Herring, and Dr. Boninghausen. Let's see who were the low potency prescribers. As you all know, our master, Dr. Hahnemann, he always used to give the low potency. Rather, he never gave above the 30th potency. This was done so that he wanted to have a sort of an uniformity in the homeopathic posology, because there was too much of confusion during that time, what potency to give and how to repeat it. So in order to take out this controversy, Dr. Hahnemann had only restricted himself to the 30th potency. So whatever drugs he has proved in his lifetime, around 99 drugs, all of them he has used in the low potency. Even Dr. Dunham, Dr. Robert, and Dr. Boyd, Dr. Richard Hughes, Dr. Bolen, Dr. Sirkar, Dr. D. N. Roy, Dr. Cameron, Dr. Anschutz, and Dr. Borick. They were also low potency prescribers. So each one of them had their own way of prescribing. So this is all about the indication, contraindications of high, medium, and low potency, with a short note on the ascending scale of potencies. So I hope you all like my lecture and you all can understand it. I've tried to make it as simple as possible so that you all can remember it and get good marks in your examination.